You're not going to be caught up in the voice. Does anybody want to do this? Okay. I think it would probably be useful to do at least some of them in order not to get lost in the course of the study. This applies to both of them in my judgment. Anyway, so yesterday we talked about the definition of style manifolds of J-convex functions, integrable complex structures, and stated the main theorem that I want to prove today and tomorrow, namely under certain topological conditions on smooth manifold, this manifold that means the structure of the prime manifold. And today we'll be entirely devoted to one step in the theorem, which is constructing J-convex functions. If you remember from yesterday, the one step in the proof was to extend an integrable complex structure over a handle, and we'll attach a handle to your manifold. And the second step would be, once we extended the complex structure over the handle, we need to extend a J-convex function over the handle. And this is what I'll be saying today. Tomorrow we'll then conclude. So first, some general constructions one can do with J-convex functions. So let me first talk about hypersurfaces. So as always, Vj is a complex manifold. So I'm assuming it's integral, and the dimension, complex dimension, is always n. Now let's consider sigma in V a real hypersurface. So it's a smooth hypersurface. Of dimension 2n minus 1. So it's real co-dimension 1 hypersurface. Okay, so it's in B. And now at any point we can look at the following quantity. We can look at the tangent space to sigma at a point x. Then we take the image under the complex structure and we take its intersection. So this I will call psi x. This will be a hyperplane in the tangent space of sigma. So we have the tangent space of sigma here. And in this tangent space of sigma, we have psi at the point x, which is a co-dimension 1 subspace of the tangent space of sigma. So, which means that psi over sigma is a hyperplane distribution. It's a field of co-dimension 1 subspaces. And now, this I will call the field of complex tangencies, because you see these spaces are invariant now under multiplication by J, because that's how I define them. They are the maximal complex subspaces containing the tangent space of sigma. Sigma is odd dimension, so it cannot be complex, but if you reduce dimension by 1, then you find a complex subspace of the maximal dimension. And so this is the field of complex tangencies. Now, you can write psi as the kernel of the one form alpha on sigma. So alpha is a one form on sigma. And I want to fix the sign of this one form by assuming that sigma is co-oriented. So let's assume we have a vector field of sigma defined in co-orientation. So from now on, then we always assume that hypersurfaces are co-oriented. And I mean, what I said before doesn't mean co-orientation, but now I want to fix the psi sine of alpha by requiring. If I take this normal vector field in sigma, I can map it by j, 1 to j times mu, and I want that alpha of j times mu should be positive. So you fix the sine of alpha by this convention using the co-orientation. And then we can take d alpha, it's a 2 form, and we restrict it to this hyperplane distribution side. So that means on every hyperplane side we have a 2 form now, and this 2 form is well defined up to multiplication by a positive function. And so this is well defined. And there's some choice of alpha. Yeah? I'm just prescribing the kernel, but I can mostly scale alpha by some function, but only by a positive function for this definition. And this is the only ambiguity. Yeah, so this doesn't depend on alpha up to a positive function. And now let me call this omega sigma, this is a true form on the side, and this is called the Levy form. Sigma. Yes?
Just to make things clear in my head.
Yes.
So mu is the normal sine in tangent space to sigma.
No, mu is normal to sigma.
So tangent to sigma.
U is normal to sigma, and I can choose U such that J times U is tangent to sigma, but will be normal to sigma.
But it's not inside.
Oh, well, the picture was that J times U is inside, sorry. J times, yeah, there is some dimensions here, right? So, yes, thank you. So J times U, I can choose to be tangent to sigma, but it will be transverse to sigma. Yeah, it's not inside. It follows all back from the definition itself.
And omega sigma is a two-form on sigma? Or
it's a two-form on side. I only consider it on side. I mean, in principle, you can look at this two-form on sigma, but we only want to look at it on side. So this is called the Levy form on sigma, but it's only a two-form on side. Okay, then we say that hypersurface sigma is J convex if and only if this Levy form is positive on complex size. So omega sigma of V J times V is positive for all non-zero V inside. So now because this related to J convexity of functions, this is the next slide. So if you have a function which is J convex, and say it's without critical points, so we take some all levels that are regular, then every level set is a hypersurface and every level set is J convex. More generally, if you test critical points, you take a regular level set, it will be always J convex. And to show this, you just pick as your form alpha, as a defining form alpha, you can choose a particular one, maybe you take minus e, c, e, for the defining form alpha, and then with that you see that J convexity of phi precisely is positivity of 3 uniform. So this is easy. And conversely, if all the level sets are J-convex and regular, then the function is almost J-convex already. Then F composed V will be J-convex. For a sufficiently convex function F from R to R. You've seen already yesterday that if we have a J convex function, we can always compose with a convex function from R to R, a convex decreasing function from R to R. And conversely, if all the level sets are J convex as hypersurfaces, then by composing with a sufficiently convex function, we can make the function J convex. So all that's missing for J convex is the function is only in the direction transverse to sigma. And we can achieve that by composing with a function. This is actually true if all the level sets are compact. So let's say if all the level sets are compact, then with this I'm sure it's true. So that means when we want to construct J-convex functions, it's enough to construct functions all of whose level sets are J-convex. So, and this leads to a definition. I'm not sure how much I will use it, but it's a useful concept if you do more construction with it. Say, a function phi from V to R, we call it JLC, and LC stands for level convex. And we didn't come up with a better name for that. If near the critical point is J convex, and all level sets are J convex. J convex outside the critical point. So at the critical point or in the neighborhood of the critical point, we still require J convex in the original sense. But then when outside, we only need to require the total level set of J convex. And then by composing with a sufficient convex function, we can make the function J convex if needed. So this simplifies already the task of constructing the convex function. Oh, by the way, one remark is if hypersurface is J convex, then this condition implies that Xi is a convex function. Yeah, just to link this to a Xi is a convex function. that's the inequality that phi of phi, and that's the term which comes from epsilon over 4 r squared, is less than equal to 1 over 2 pi, integrate from 0 to 2 pi, phi of phi plus r times phi theta. So which means for every point C, we take a circle around C of radius R, and R should be small. So for this specifically small R, this is some, well, if we had Laplace P equal to 0, we wouldn't have this term, and we would have equality. This is the mean value inequality for harmonic functions, which many of you may have seen. And if you have greater than equal to 0, you get the mean value inequality for subharmonic functions. And if you have some strict inequality, you can accommodate as a term here on the left hand side. So this is how this comes out. It's not very difficult. So you see, the nice thing is that this mean value inequality now does not involve derivatives of the function phi. So we can take this as a definition for a continuous function, the eigenvex. So here I assume the function is smooth to do this computation, but then if I have a function which is only C0, only continuous, then I define it as the eigenvex by this property. Okay. And once we know what eigenvexity means for functions on a complex plane, we can do it for functions on curves, on complex curves, by just going to local coordinates. And then to go to higher dimension manifolds, we say a continuous function phi on a complex manifold called J convex if its restriction to every complex curve is J convex defined in one node complex point. Yeah? So phi restricted to C is J convex for every complex curve. So we have a definition of J convex functions on arbitrary complex manifolds. So how are we going to this? The first lemma, this one I actually want to prove, because it's so simple, is if you have two continuous J convex functions, P and C, say, then you can take the maximum, so those are continuous functions. Okay. Then you can take their maximum. The maximum of two continuous functions is again continuous. And then the maximum is again J1x. You see, I mean, even if you start with smooth functions, the maximum of the smooth function will in general not be better than continuous. And so this is why we need to go to continuous function, because we want to apply this maximum construction. And so even if you start with smooth ones here, this will be zero. Okay, so how does this follow? But it reduces to the case of just subset of C. And for subset of C, we just need to check that this inequality survives the maximum construction. So let's write down this inequality for the function the maximum of E and C. Yeah? So let me just write the maximum of E and C. So, and then we, from those two, we get that we can now make this even smaller if we replace it. So this will be true for one, for some epsilon, maybe in fact a slightly different epsilon. This is some epsilon belonging to phi, and this is some epsilon belonging to phi. And from these two, you get that the maximum of phi and phi at the point z plus the minimum of epsilon phi over 4 r squared is less than equal to 1 over 2 pi integral 0 to pi and the maximum of phi and phi of this equation here. So you see that the value inequality survives just the constant epsilon, but becomes smaller. If you have two different constants, you need to take the smaller one. That works for the maximum. So now, eventually, we want to construct smooth day-convex functions, and these continuous day-convex functions will only be an intermediate step. And for this, we need a procedure to turn continuous functions again into smooth ones. This is an old theorem by Richberg. From the 1960s. Richberg, yeah? I'm not sure which nationality it was. So he proved that any continuous J-convex function on a complex manifold can be C0 approximated by smooth J-convex functions. So you can find arbitrarily C0 close to continuous J-convex when you find this J-convex function.
But if I take
this
whatever smooth function is C0 close to a J-convex.
Yeah, it's not going to be J-convex. So if your original, I don't think that is true if your J-convex function only continues. So it's, if you start with a smooth J-convex function, then because it's an open condition, any sufficiently close smooth function will automatically be J-convex. But it needs to be C2 close. It needs to be C2 close.
But this integral seems to be, this inequality seems to be true for C0 close.
This inequality, you need to exactly prove that this survives the So let me actually give the argument. So the proof is roughly the following. So you can write a smoothing explicitly locally on Cn. So on Cn, you pick any function rho. Non-negative real numbers, which is compactly supported and has integral equal to 1. And then you can, given any delta positive, you can rescale this function. You define a function rho delta of z to be rho of z divided by delta. So you make this point much smaller and you need to divide by delta the 2n here on Cn to keep the integral equal to 1, and then you can explicitly write a smoothing of any continuous function. We have a function phi right smoothing phi delta of hex as the integral of phi of x minus y rho delta y dy. And you can easily show that for every positive delta, this function is smooth. And at C0 close, as delta gets small, this C0 converges to the original function, phi. And now with this explicit definition, now you can insert this into the mean value inequality and just integrate both sides of the mean inequality in this pipeline computation, which I mainly got from you, and then show that if phi satisfies this inequality, then the smooth function also satisfies it. So, and then you just need to do the same thing on a complex manifold, but also going to the holomorphic coordinates. Then every coordinate patch you can smoothen it, and then you need to still patch them together on the manifold. So that's some of the more work to be done to patch things together from local coordinates. But the main computation is this one. Just check that this is mean where the inequality satisfies this explicit smoothing procedure. Okay.
Why does it even have a problem when you patch?
Yes, but the point is when you patch, you're already dealing with smooth functions, and then you use exactly what Klaus said, that if you have two smooth functions, and then if you deform them a little bit, you keep them C2 close, then you preserve J convexity. So you make them smooth in every coordinate patch, and you check that. So if you you did some smoothing in one coordinate patch, and now you want to the next coordinate patch. Then here, on this overlapping region, your function is already smooth. It's already C2. So after I apply smoothing here, first with here, then I want to apply smoothing here. So and I just forget about this one and just choose this function. But the function I had from the other side was already C2 here. And now you prove that if you have a function which is already C2 and you do this smoothing procedure, then for delta small, this smooth function will be C2 close to the original one. And hence, if you have two functions which are both J-convex and they are C2 close, you can interpolate. Okay? Yeah? So this. Yeah? So you need to be a bit careful about the. Okay, so we can again smoothen continuous J-convex functions. So as a corollary, so I want to state four corollaries of this result which we're going to use. So the first one is that if you have two smooth functions,
some
suppose we are given two plane convex functions, C and C, on the whole manifold. They're smooth, plane convex, such that for all x in L at points on L, the functions coincide. And also their differentials coincide. So E, E at the point X is E, E at the point X. So we have a totally Wilson manifold, L at the point X. And along this totally Wilson manifold, we have two plane convex functions which coincide the first order along this sum manifold. So the function and the first derivatives coincide, but second derivatives may be different. Then we can find a new plane convex function, again smooth, say theta, such that theta equals, say, the function phi outside a neighborhood of L, so outside some neighborhood which we give ourselves here, we want to have the function phi, and in a smaller neighborhood, we want it to be the function z. So we can interpolate to find the taking wave function which outside the neighborhood agrees with phi, and in the smaller neighborhood of L agrees with. Yes, always without boundary, so compact without boundary. So let me draw one picture to show how this is done. So let's pick some division metric and let's take the distance square from L. Function on a neighborhood of L is J convex. Okay, so now let's draw here. Here we have L, and here I draw schematically the distance from L. So this is going away from L in the radial direction, and we have some function. And I choose my order such that my function phi in this drawing looks just like the horizontal line, and then we have some other function phi, which the value here coincides with the value of phi, and the derivative also coincides, and then it's doing something. Yeah. So let's say it's this. Now, because they coincide the first order here, if I add to this function phi the large multiple of this distance square function, which increases very fast, I can make it larger than phi. So I can somehow take this function, which will be phi plus a times rho for some very large constant a. If I make a large, I can make this function to be bigger than phi in some. Now let's take. Now there's one computation one needs to make which doesn't follow from anything I said so far. It turns out that you can take this function, follow it for a little bit, and then still connect it up, down to the function phi, such keeping the whole thing J convex. This doesn't look very convex, so there's some extra computation one needs to do, that there exists some function, say, phi bar with this property, coincides with this function near L, and then outside connected back to phi, and it's J convex. Now once we have that, then we make another perturbation. So now we take this function p bar, and here we make a very small perturbation, just pushing it slightly down. We can make this c2 small, so this is easy. We make c2 small perturbation, just pushing it down slightly. So this is still the J convex. Let's call this function v hat maybe. Yeah. You still with me? Mm-hmm. Okay. Now we're done. Now the function we're looking for will be theta. Will be we take the smoothing of the maximum of this function v hat and c vl, so say in this region we take it to be the smoothing of this function. So this new function will look like this function, and then outside we just follow the function v bar.
Are graphs in some one-dimensional direction.
So this is on some complex manifold, and in some region of the complex manifold, I split it as a one-dimensional direction and some
remaining directions.
And I have two hypersurfaces which are both graphs. Then I claim I can build a new hypersurface out of those two by basically taking the minimum of those two graphs and a new hypersurface, which is like this. And this new hypersurface, the same double drive, will again be taken place. And you can again smoothen it. So that it's smooth and arbitrarily close to the minimum of the two graph of the function. And this follows by just writing this as level sets of some J-convex function and then apply the maximum construction to the J-convex function. So you write sigma as, let's say this point is y, this is x, as y minus f of x equals 0, where this is some J-convex function. And sigma prime is y minus g of x equals 0. And then you take the maximum of those two functions. So what is the maximum of y minus f of x, y minus g of x? This is y minus the minimum of f and g of x. So if you set f equal to 0, this is precisely the hypersurface as I draw it. Okay? Now those will be functions which have some J-convex hypersurface, so you compose them with some convex function to make the function J-convex, apply the maximum construction, so this function J-convex will take the zero level and this is the size of the hypersurface. Okay. So we can also kind of build new hypersurfaces out of only ones by this construction. And finally, there's a very useful result, which is the following. Suppose we are given a complex manifold, which, I mean, this doesn't have to be algebraic, there can be any manifold there. So let's again consider such a product situation, where, say, we have 0, 1, and here in this direction is some manifold. And the whole thing is a complex manifold. So it's like a complex cobordism. And suppose we're given a family of J-convex hypersurfaces, which are all graph-like in this direction. And this family starts down here. And then the next one in the family is made like this, the next one is like that, the next one is like this, then something like that, and it ends up here. So it's a smooth family of hypersurfaces. So these are hypersurfaces sigma t, they are all J-convex for t in 0, 1, and they start and end on the two boundaries. Okay. Then I can turn this family of J-convex hypersurfaces into a foliation. So claim there exists a foliation. By hypersurfaces sigma tilde t from 0 to 1, which again start from the boundary and end on the boundary. So the point is that I can somehow pull these hypersurfaces apart to turn them into a foliation. So how do we do that? The proof is you write sigma t as y minus, say, equals ft of x. And now let's consider the function gt to be the minimum over for all s greater than equal to t of fs. So you replace every function whose graph is this hypersurface, you replace it by the minimum of all the functions describing the hypersurface above that. Now, but in this way, you make this family GT monotone GT just artificially. So this is less than equal to GT prime if T is less than equal to T prime. Okay? Yes? If you think about this, then this is automatically becoming monotone in T if I write the minimum. Because then if I increase T, I take a bit more smaller set, so it's only becoming larger. Yeah? So this is monotone increasing. Now you see, this is like the minimum construction on hypersurfaces, but not on two, but on a whole family. Yes.
So what's the state then? So you have this family of sigma.
Then there's also a foliation sigma T tilde, and they also start down here and they end down end like that. And they, yes, it's okay, but I'm starting with some arbitrary complex manifold. I didn't even know to start with that I have a foliation which looks like this. Yeah. Okay, you're saying you can just take this. But I'm not assuming that these hypersets are J-convex. Yeah.
So that's why it's not.
They might not be J-convex. Yeah. In the obvious one. Because I make no assumption what J is. J is not product or anything, or a variable or anything else. Yeah. So J is completely arbitrary. So this family might actually be much more complicated. But there exists such a correlation. Okay. So this is the monotone. Now, so you see, this looks like a corollary 3 if I take the minimum of some function and their graphs, then they define J-convex hypersurfaces, so they can smooth them. Instead of two hypersurfaces, they can take a continuous family and I can smooth all of them using corollary 3, preserving this monotonicity. Now you see, now I have a family again of graphs, of hypersurfaces. Graphs, and they are J convex. They are again made smooth, and they are now weakly monotone in the sense that it's almost a foliation. Yeah? It's the hypersurface is this is if I take sigma t prime to be y equals gt of x, they satisfy almost everything except that they could still just be tangent. Yeah. But they can never actually have crossing, so they're already weakly monotone. And then you just stretch them a little bit to make them a complex foliation. So it again requires some work, but the basic idea is this that you
do you still assume that they have just graphs of functions?
Yes, so I assume that they always, I'm constructing them again as graphs of functions. Yeah. And the reason is that I always want to assure this construction that everything has no critical points, so I don't get it. So this construction turns out to be extremely useful because to construct some foliation by just purely constructing family.
And maybe tangent to each other makes an equilibrium. Can they be tangent to each other?
Yeah, yeah.
Make made points.
Yes.
And then it's really
good. You need to afterwards just add some small shift in the vertical direction to them, keeping them C2 close to a slightly equivalent part. And then all the tangents will go away. And even if you have infinitely tangencies, you just take the upper one and you shift it just slightly in the vertical direction. And if you shift them a lot, you don't know that they remain in J-convex. But if you shift them just a little bit, so they are C2 close, then they will stay J-convex, because again, J-convex is a C2 condition. So now, remember, we wanted to construct some extension of J-convex function over integers. So
R n minus. N minus k of curve. Let me find the only thing. Yeah, I can find out this here. Which looks as follows. So let me draw a large picture. And in fact, this function will be a function only of two variables. It will depend on points only through two expressions where capital R is the square root of x1 squared plus xk squared. So this is the norm in some k-dimensional totally real direction. And little r is the norm in the remaining 2n minus k directions. So it's xk plus 1 squared plus x n squared plus y1 squared plus yn squared. So we will in fact construct a function which depends on the complex on only through these two expressions. So it will be a function only these two variables. So I'm drawing little r here. Now remember we have a standard function to which we want to connect it, say phi standard of r is a times little r squared minus capital, sorry, the other way around, a times, no, this is a times little r squared minus capital r squared. And we want the function, so this will be some small gamma, positive but small, and this will be 1. Then we go up to 1 plus gamma, then we have 1 here maybe. Okay. So we want the function to coincide with the standard function near the boundary of this standard interval. So what do the level sets of the standard function look like? Well, they look something like this. This is level set of the standard function. Okay. And now we want to find the new function which coincides with the standard function near the boundary of this. And inside is the following, so up here say this is maybe still the same. And then we take one level set here and say we take the level set here. And now we bend this down very sharply to some delta here, so that this level set is going over the core of the handle. And then somehow interpolate. So this would be the new function. So there is a J-convex function which looks like this, where I can take any level set and pull it down to go over there.
This is the statement of the theorem.
That there exists a J-convex function on the standard angle which looks like this. So I'm just drawing the level set of the function, which has this shape. And so let's consider this, call this particular level set sigma, and it turns out that unfortunately I will not have time to explain the construction of this level set. So it turns out the main point in the construction is constructing this one level set, which is bent down like this, and to show that you can do it keeping the level set J convex. Once you have that, then using this last corollary, we only have to connect this level set sigma to some level set of the standard function by any family of J convex hypersurfaces. And then we apply the last corollary to turn that family of J convex hypersurfaces into a foliation. And once we have a foliation, we can take those the leaves as level sets of a J-convex function. And the same to the upside. So the main point is really constructing this one particular hypersurface sigma, and this is done by some explicit computation. So you take some hypersurface which is described in these two coordinates, and you work out some condition on this function to be J convex. This is some differential inequality on the second derivative of this function, and you need to construct some solution of this. You can write sigma, for example, as graph of a function. And then you need to work out what is the condition on this function f for sigma to be I convex. So it becomes some condition on this function f, some differential inequality. In fact, it's several differential inequalities. It's a system of differential inequalities, and it's not entirely obvious to solve it, although it's completely elementary, just function of one variable. But it took us a long time to actually construct solutions of this system of differential inequalities. But you can, and once you have them, then you apply our previous functions.
You can meet to write it down?
No, you cannot write it down, actually. You cannot write it down. Yeah, I cannot, yeah, it's a bit ridiculous, yeah, but I cannot write down. We really have some 20-page proof that such a function exists. We cannot just write down a formula. It's surprisingly difficult.
Everything is fixed on the top, everything is fixed.
Yeah, you just.
So when you have a foliation and you want to build a function that has a level sense, I mean, the foliation you get is already smooth or obviously?
Yes, the foliation is already smooth.
And that does it give you automatically a smooth function? You have to
yes.
Send it up.
No. Is it, well, if you have a smooth foliation, then you define a function to have constant values on the level, that's automatically a smooth function. Yeah? If you have a smooth foliation. This just follows from the definition of this foliation, that this function is smooth. So then you have a smooth function, all of whose level sets are J-convex. And then we again compose with some convex function and make the whole function J-convex. But we don't have to smooth anymore, it's already smooth. So that last step. So I'm done. Any more questions? Yeah.
So if everything is based on this integral at the beginning, but this is only true for real complex and for properly proper.
For integral complex structure.
So otherwise this wouldn't work.
Otherwise this wouldn't work. So here's actually for those of you who didn't do the homework. Can you get that?
Yeah, yeah. So somehow when you do this approximation, right, this big picture, you will probably use a rather when you need to get the sort of this new isology.
Yes. So what is the limit? So how does coherency 2 come into the picture? We want to implant this handle now and want to attach it to some given domain. So maybe just draw one more picture. So the way you want to apply is we're given some domain with J convex boundary on which we already constructed some J convex function which has boundaries at regular level sets. Then we attach a handle to this. So here's the attaching sphere of the handle. And then we use corollary 2 to pull back the function that we already given down here to the standard handle, but when we put it back under some holomorphic coordinate chart, it will not look like the standard function. And we use corollary 2 to modify the function so that in the neighborhood of this looks like the standard function. And then this is like the standard function that we're given up here. Yeah. Okay. So that's where we use corollary 2 to first deform this so we have the standard function near the attaching sphere of the handle. And then we're in this modern situation, we just need to construct this function of the standard.
Any more questions? Okay. Thank you.